Sound Words. Christian Magazine. Republished by Irving Risch, host of Down to Earth but Heavenly Minded podcast. In this issue, I thought I would group 9 brief articles together. They are more than conquerors, the same Jesus, God's discipline, contemplating him, nearness to Christ, we will come unto him and make our abode with him, come, and rest, they spake often one to another, individual blessing. More than conquerors. There is a difference between the conflict referred to in Ephesians chapter 6 and that in Romans chapter 8, conformably with the doctrine of each epistle. In Ephesians, if also one speaks with a necessary diffidence, it is that the saint might stand in the truth, power and communion, testimony to the authorities in the heavenlies of his heavenly standing in Christ. In a walk consistent therewith. In Romans chapter 8 it is different. The question is whether the saint is to languish under the distresses which characterize this desert scene, through which he passes, under the shadow of him who once held the might of death. Or whether in the bright shining of the power and victory, and above all, the love of him who passed through everything in that love to secure us. And the love of him to whom everything and everyone is creature. In what triumph, in the light of Christ, do those words come, nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors, through him that loved us. So, accusations met by Christ's intercession on high. And the light of this twofold expression of love in the valley below, with what sweetness of embrace do the words meet us, the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yes, beloved. We are no longer in Adam, with its entail of sin and death, but we are in Christ for life, righteousness, Christian standing, a new circle in which we are made to feel at home. With the immensity potentially of that wondrous term, in Christ before us, but at home there with God, who has so acted towards us, has developed throughout in the doctrine of the epistle. Death has proved to be our liberator on the one hand, and the exposition of the mighty all-prevailing love of God, on the other. Psalm chapter 44, from which verse 36 of our chapter is a quotation, could hardly go as far as this in an as yet unaccomplished redemption. Yet the faithful remnant there find themselves the companions of the king in Psalm chapter 45, our position, too, through grace, Hebrews chapter 1 verse 9, Hebrews chapter 3 verse 14, and in Psalm chapter 46 find the covenant name of Jehovah restored to them. But what a God is ours, and how truly is it the gospel of God, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, Romans chapter 1 verse 1, and 3. C.N. Snow. We triumph in thy triumphs, Lord, thy joys our deepest joys afford. The fruit of love divine. The same Jesus. The same powerful right hand that held the 7 stars of the 7 churches is laid so gently upon John as he falls as dead at the feet of the glorious Son of Man. And the same mighty voice that sounded like many waters, said in tenderness to the heart of the troubled seer. Fear not, I am the first and the last. Yes. It is the same Jesus, who was once here as the man of sorrows, who is now in the place of supreme authority, from whence he searches, tests, and judges all in divine holiness and righteousness. But who still manifests in perfect love his tender care and watchfulness over his own. God's discipline. I may be called on to pass through pain, and sorrow, and trial, as a part of his discipline, but everything that comes from God, comes from a source and spring in which I have confidence. I look through the circumstances to him, and nothing can separate from his love. Ellipsis. God cannot rest in the corruption of sin. He can only rest in that which is perfectly holy. And because he who thus rests is love and loves us, he makes us understand that he will bring us into his own rest, into his own delight. Now let the soul once know what the rest of God is, let the heart be once set upon it. There will be joy unspeakable in understanding that God's love can rest in nothing short of bringing us into his own delight. There will then also be the full settled consciousness that we cannot find rest elsewhere. J. N. Darby. Contemplating him. Do you contemplate him? I have heard people talk of reading some biography, and express themselves with the greatest delight over the lovely life of the person written of. Well, I am studying Christ, I am contemplating his excellency, learning to see him as God saw him. But you can never get up to it. No, I cannot, but I can contemplate it, and as I do so be changed into the same image from glory to glory. J. B. Stoney. Nearness to Christ. When we get hold of a glorified Christ, and the Holy Ghost has come down to tell us of him, one does not know how, but things drop off, like old leaves pushed off by new. One gets clear of things almost unconsciously. Natural things lose their attraction and interest. A careful historian of his own soul knows his different besetments, and he does not know how to get free from them. But if he gets near Christ, he is set free without knowing how. Not only am I in the closest relationship to him, but it is a character of union of a wondrous order. He is the source of all my supplies. I have no head but Christ. I have Christ's part, I have Christ's mind, I have Christ's wisdom, and nothing else will suit me but his place. J. B. Stoney. We will come unto him, and make our abode with him. John chapter 14 verse 23. This wonderful promise was made by the Lord Jesus to him who kept his word. Such obedience could only flow from the heart that loved him, and the consequence of love to the Son is the outflow of the Father's love. A similar thought is found in John chapter 16 verse 27, but a different word for love is used. Christ's word can only be really known by those who love him. It is one thing to know the letter of Scripture, and another to know the word of Christ, although it is only as we know the Scriptures that we can learn his word in communion with him. Mary of Bethany, in Luke chapter 10 verse 39, shows how his word is learned and known. It is possible to know, as a professing Christian, the will of the Lord in measure. A knowledge that brings with it great responsibility, Luke chapter 12 verse 47, but it is another thing entirely to know the Lord's mind and will, as having sat at his feet like Mary, and lain in his bosom. Like John, John chapter 13 verses 23 to 26. Moreover, the mere professor has no power to carry out the will of the master he professes to serve, but the true disciple, while learning of the Lord's mind, enters into the enjoyment of his love. And it is in the power of responsive love that obedience subsists. Come, and rest. Come ye yourselves apart and rest a while. How rich the recompense for hours of toil, the presence of our Lord. To him without the camp let us draw near with hearts where perfect love has cast out fear, and in such gracious tender accents hear his ever precious word. Come ye yourselves apart to sacred bower where dew drops glisten on the fragrant flower, is this our place of rest? Nay, he who chose the desert bleak and lone, where round his holy form the wind did moan, must give no shelter to his own than on his loving breast. Come ye yourselves apart, in days of old exultant followers their triumphs told to one who sympathized. How they the feeble mind and limb made sound, the fettered captive's cruel chains unbound, his reassuring smile their service crowned, and this they greatly prized. Come ye yourselves apart, O tender call, stifling the sob within the breasts of all the loyal friends of John. He who for Christ such splendid witness bore was dead, the voice of one would cry no more. They came and found where all was dark before the light of noonday shone. Come ye yourselves apart and rest a while. May we know more the sweetness of the smile he still in glory wears for those who in the attitude of prayer with him their every joy and sorrow share. Christ only has the ever open ear, he only knows and cares. E. Scougal. They spake often one to another. There is not much to show in these words, but there is much in them. It was the time of the utter decadence of the people, everything worth having was gone, nothing was left but misery and godless pride. What could be done in such circumstances? Yet there were those who feared the Lord. Anyway, nobody, nothing could take that from those who had it. Then, what did they do? They did not preach, or make public orations, they had no prophet by whose words they could be spellbound for the time being, even though they would not obey them, there was no Elijah. They had to wait for his reappearance to rebuild the altar with the 12 stones of a united people, there was no king to deliver them from the stranger's yoke. They had no power to recover the position in the world which their unfaithfulness had lost to them, they had no ground of visible encouragement in the distressful circumstances. It was no time to sing the songs of Zion, to proclaim the divinely appointed privileges, or even to call a general prayer meeting. What then? What could they do? They spake often one to another. In the informal conversations, one member of the company was as good as another, none had anything in which to display his superiority. In which to boast in the time of national humiliation, every voice in the company was formed in the common fear of God, and every utterance, however simple or illiterate, expressed that fear. Moreover, it was no mere Sabbath day formalism. Days, hours, times, did not govern their conversations. It was no perfunctory thing to be done, and to be done with. They spake often one to another. How often? That depended on the fellowship of the Spirit, and the opportunity afforded them, as it is said, as often as ye do it, until he come. And is it not striking, the exceeding simplicity? Shorn of every adventitious appendage, of that anchor word to keep the hearts of his disciples steadfast through all the stress of times, remember me. No artifice of the enemy. No failure of the church in whole or in part, can rob the feeblest saint of that. It was left by the Lord at the Last Supper, to bind the hearts of his own to himself through all time until he comes. It imposed no burden, it enforced no duty, it demanded no sacrifice, it required no power, it prescribed no ritual, it set forth no times, but only, as often as, until. A word without a command. A direction without enforcement, a trumpet call without a fixed rallying point, a standard without a bearer, a voice without a crier, a rule, but one of love. It remains by its very simplicity indestructible and efficient for the gathering of every heart loyal to himself ever since. And after the same manner of simplicity and efficiency is the picture of Malachi chapter 3 verse 16, and an immense comfort for us today as we consider it. The times are evil and getting more so. How long we shall retain the little we have outwardly, who can say? And the question is becoming more than ever serious. Then, when all hope is gone, Acts chapter 27 verse 20, what remains in the face of difficulties insurmountable? God and the word of his grace, Acts chapter 20 verse 32. Acts 27 is instructive as regards the dispensation, John's writings as to what abides unto eternal life. E.C. fearing the Lord, and thinking on his name, the faithful few together often spake. The faithful now his promised presence claim, remembering him, who suffered for their sake. Individual blessing. The least of all saints can never be overlooked by him, or distinguished from others, either in time or eternity. We are loved as individuals, saved and glorified as individuals. The truth is clearly taught in Luke chapter 15, and John also speaks much of our individual blessing, the family of God being his principal theme, as the church of God is Paul's, and the wilderness journey Peter's. Yet it is Paul who says, who loved me, and gave himself for me. Paul here speaks as if he were the only one that Christ loved and died for. Faith appropriates what grace reveals. It is only in this way that the heart enjoys the revelations of grace. Understandest thou this, O my soul? It is all important. This is the province of faith alone. It makes the blessing, however great, personal. No matter what grace reveals in Christ, as the children's portion, faith is sure to say, it is mine. A. Miller.